day. We thank you for this hour. We thank you for everything that you've done thus far. It is now time for the word of God. We pray that a word will educate, illuminate, and change lives in the mighty name of Jesus. That it will lift up the hung down head. That it will renew the spirit and will stir up the gifts that are within us. We thank you right now for everyone under the sound of my voice. That they be attentive and attuned to your word. And let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Amen. Turn with me to the Gospel of Mark, the 16th chapter. Feels mighty nice in here. So let's keep that going.
Let's have church.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mark, 16th chapter. I was told if you put something in, you can get something out. Hallelujah. If you ride your car on E, you're not going to get anything out of it. Hallelujah. So let's fill up. And let's get something out of this. Glory, hallelujah. Y'all may be giving my church. Hallelujah, let's have church. Mark 16, beginning at the 14th verse. Later, he appeared to the 11 themselves as they were sitting at the table, and he upbraided them for their lack of faith and stubbornness, because they had not believed those who saw him after he had risen. And he said to them, go into all the world and proclaim the good news to the whole creation. The one who believes and is baptized will be saved, but the one who does not believe will be condemned. And these signs shall accompany those who believe. By using my name they will cast out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up snakes in their hands. And if they drink any deadly thing, it will not hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. So far the scriptures.
Amen.
Our thought, your mission, should you accept it?
Come on, doctor.
Your mission. Should you accept it? The book of Mark, written by John Mark on the works of Jesus, given to him by Peter. Mark tells of Jesus coming to earth to bring salvation that was prophesied in the Old Testament. Victory over Satan and sin, and written to Gentile Christians to help them understand Jewish customs, which would also help them understand the Jewish Messiah's purpose in the world. Prior to our text, Jesus had appeared to Mary Magdalene and two other disciples who had gone back to the remaining 11 to tell them they had seen Jesus. But the brothers would not believe. The sightings of Jesus were important to show he lived, that he had risen from the dead just like he said. But if the 11 would not believe, it would have all stopped right there. Because if the eyewitnesses could not verify and give their account, how could they, or how would they be able to convince the world? People know when you are sincere and believe what you are saying, just as wise people know the con man or the con woman schemes to get you to believe what they say and part with your money. Bernie Madoff built his multi-billion dollar Ponzi scheme off the ability to be that convincing. So the disciples had to believe that Jesus had risen. They had to accept that he was risen. If they did not believe it, how could they go out and preach it? If you don't believe that God has blessed you, how can you convince others how blessed you are? In our text, Jesus rebuked the 11 for their lack of faith. and for not accepting the verified multi-witness accounts. As it was in Mosaic law and spoken by Jesus in Matthew 18:16, that the truth would be established by more than one witness. And the disciples had doubled down in their disbelief. Fear will make you do some crazy thing. Fear will make you doubt what you know. Fear will make you turn around and run away from something that has been confirmed.
Yes.
That's how powerful fear is.
That's right.
You gotta know that. Because some people say, oh no, nothing bothers me. Stuff bothers you.
Come on.
You just don't tell anybody. Stuff scares you. You just look mean and you look like nothing scares you. But the truth be told, on the inside, quaking and shaking.
Amen.
Jesus then issues what is called the Great Commission, which is to go into all the world and preach the gospel for the purpose to bring salvation to all that believe and condemnation to those who would not accept. The misconception, though, is that many so-called Christians have overlooked throughout time is that the Holy Spirit condemns and not us. I need to say that again. The Holy Spirit condemns, not us.
Amen.
For years, we have sent people to a burning hell. During the Crusades, entire Islamic, Jewish, and Christian Orthodox communities were wiped out, according to the World History Encyclopedia, as the Crusaders attacked the Muslims. You see, if you are blinded enough, you can even turn on those with similar values. So you need to get this. We sometimes are seemingly battling with other denominations when we should all be on the same page.
Come on, let's go.
We say we read the same Bible.
Well, now.
So if we read the same Bible, we ought to be able to interpret it the same way. We ought not to be able to fix it to adjust to our narrow-minded conclusions, but understand what the Word of God says. So, those crusades were sanctioned by Pope Urban II. Your mission, should you accept it, is to draw them in, not drag them in. I gotta say that again. Your mission, should you accept it, is to draw them in, not drag them in. As the world waits for the global pandemic to lift and return to normal, in which normal will forever have a new meaning, challenged by all that we have experienced in mind and body, as we look at the separation and isolation, the death and devastation of the human spirit yet to be understood. Although for the child of God, we will understand it better by and by. As we remember the responses from an inept and uncompassionate president and majority Republican Congress who enabled him, acting indecisively and far too slowly to the needs of the American people, wanting all the credit and none of the blame. Your mission, should you accept it, is to rescue the perishing while providing spiritual stability. If you all over the place, they're going to be all over the place. Just like when you have kids and kid hurts and fell falls and hurts the knee. If you go, oh my God, look at my baby, he's all over the place. Child going to get upset, child going to lose it. But if you say, just sit there, I'll go get the bandage, you're going to be all right. Child calms right down. If your values are all over the place, how can you convince somebody else that you've got the right stuff? You up today, down tomorrow, oh, woe is me, present who you are. In the television show Mission Impossible on CBS between 1966 and 73,
Come on, Doc.
Every week we would meet the leader of the Mission Impossible Force, Jim Phelps, who would get an assignment for the team by recording, which would require his team of espionage experts to go in and take care of business on behalf of U.S. interests.
Yep.
This message was always sent by tape, and because of the inherent danger and secrecy attached to the nature of the mission, the voice on the tape would inform Phelps that if he or any of his people were captured, the government would disavow any knowledge of the operation. And your mission, should you accept it, would be to take out the bad guys. Good luck. And this tape will self-destruct in about 5 seconds.
Yes.
As the racial pandemic continues to rage, with black teens being shot without being given any chance to see if they will lawfully comply, and in many cases shot multiple times, Asians being beaten and bloodied by any people who were influenced by the rhetoric of the previous president,
come on,
who enjoyed the sound of his own voice, ramping up the negativity instead of looking at the facts. And while we're at it, don't go back in the Wayback Machine to try to find a reason not to support people who are under attack. Because if you do that, when you come under attack, there may not be anybody there for you. And you are supposed to know better as the children of God.
Amen.
Oh, but they didn't do anything for us, and we will not get blamed for that. It's about what you do now. It's about the God that has influenced you to do the right thing.
Amen. Amen. That's right.
Preach.
And we've heard domestic terrorists being called patriots in some cases. And even the guilty verdict in the Derek Chauvin trial seems less like justice in the eyes of many who demand consistency in our justice system that has been unfair and unequal under the law. But don't forget the words of Dr. King. The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. What does that mean, preacher? It means that though you may have been struggling a while, hold on, because your God is faithful. And what they've sown, they will also reap. You're trying to control everything. You can't control anything. You can only do what you're capable of doing. Your mission, should you accept it, is speak truth to power. Come to your own decisions, not the decisions of the mob. Be the voice of reason when those around you have lost their minds. Search for the truth in the climate of lies and the landscape of lies. You better know. Continue to apply the teachings of Christ in a responsible manner. Continue to pray that the problems of this world they can't all be solved with violence, and then violence ending in death, which doesn't make you naive, as some would say, but hopeful. I can't live my life angry. I can't live my life seeking revenge. I can't live my life in bitterness because it seems like I got a raw deal. Because I know that the raw deals will happen from time to time. And like I preached last week, it's always going to be something. And since it's always going to be something, we've got to learn how to adjust. We've got to learn how to say, how do I handle this? I don't want to handle it and make bad matters worse. Have you ever got into something you shouldn't have got into and made a bad matter worse? I want to witness, but I know nobody will stand up. I know they ain't going to talk about it. All right. Your mission, if you accept it, is to find no man shall see the Lord. Because you can't fall because the others fell. You can't shrink because the others shrunk. You can't go blind because the others can't see. You can't stop speaking for the voiceless because the others have shut up. You can't live, you can't give in. Because like the temptation said, there ain't no justice. And it got you feeling some kind of way. You can't practice unforgiveness when you have been forgiven. And I guess I need to say that again. You can't practice unforgiveness when you have been forgiven. Because you have been called to a higher purpose. And when you've been called to a higher purpose, like the disciples in the text, calling for you to do better is because you know better. And when you know better, you gotta do better. And you can't just sit back and say, I'm gonna do like the rest, because you know what God has done for you. You know where you would be if you had the same attitude as the other folks you've been talking to. You know that it would have been you in jail instead of them if you had the same attitude. You got to know that you know what's right and do right. You were raised right. And over the objections of some who want an eye for an eye, you gotta do right. When you've been raised right, you can't let others come in and tell you to do wrong. When you've been raised right, no matter how they try to put you out because you want to do right, I'll tell you what, you can do better by yourself than with the crowd who wants to go in the wrong direction. You gotta do what's right to do. Your mission, should you accept it, is to walk in love,
amen,
not hate. Your mission is to show love in the midst of your anger. Because the Bible says, be angry but sin not. So even if the killings make you angry, even if the racists continue to tell you and call you out of your name, you know that your name has been written on high. You know what your name is when Jesus calls you friend. And friend and family is what we are. Don't let anybody's name calling deter you from where you gotta be. Somebody called me a holy roller. Then I pointed out, well, your mother's a holy roller, and it didn't bother me anymore. You better know when you're talking, you better talk right.
Amen.
But don't let anybody's name calling stop you from doing what God has told you to do. Like Abraham, you are a friend of God. Your mission is to find the joy of the Lord and keep smiling through adversity and singing in the rain. Because you're not totally crazy, but crazy enough to believe that if he brought you through this and he brought you through that, he's going to keep on bringing you out. That over and over and over, he keeps on blessing me. Over and over and over, he keeps on blessing me. Somebody else said he keeps on doing great things for me. And if I had 10,000 tongues, it wouldn't be enough to say how much the Lord has done for me. Somebody else said, look what the Lord has done. He made a way out of no way. He moved all the doubts and all my fears and allowed me to walk in the nice places. He leads me beside the still waters. The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. And as he makes me to lie down in the green pastures, leads me by the still waters. Well, what does he do for you then? He restores my soul. He restores me when the enemy has frenzy. He restored me. Said, go over there. Sit down for a little while. I'm going to meet you there. And when I meet you there, I'm coming with peace. Your mission, should you accept it, is walk daily in the Lord. Your mission, should you accept it, is walking upright before the Lord. Your mission is to let your light so shine, hallelujah, before all men, that they may see your good works and glorify the Father who is in heaven. Your mission is to keep the light burning. Your mission is to keep a light in your window, because every now and then somebody's going to stop by and they need to know when they come into your house, you're going to tell them what's right. When they come to your house, you're going to feed them good food. When they come to your house, you're not going to get gossip, but you're going to get the truth and the word of God. Your mission, should you accept it, is at times you're going to be lonely because you tell the truth. But I found out people will run from you when you tell the truth, because they don't want to hear the truth. But that's all right, because most days I got Jesus and that's enough. And no matter who comes and who goes, my God has always been there and will always be there. Let the light from the lighthouse shine on me. And we gotta keep it shining in the darkness, because somebody needs to see that we haven't all gone to the wayside. That the church is open, whether I'm in the building or I'm out of the building. The church is open because I got the church in me. And that I can't talk about you, but that I am more than a conqueror through him that loved me. My mission, your mission, is to accept that I've been called and paid for with a price. And the price was paid back on Calvary, that God saw fit for his son to die for your sin and my sin. Your mission is to walk knowing that these signs shall follow you, not you following a sign, because that's how the cultists roll. Somebody always looking for the next new thing, but I keep walking and the signs shall follow me. Not only the signs, but goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord. But before I get to heaven, assignment of the enemy that was sent to defeat you. Your mission, should you accept it, is to be steadfast, unmovable, always, always, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know, your labor, sometimes you get tired, but your labor, sometimes you get weak, but your labor is not in vain. Your labor is not in vain. In the Lord, in the Lord, in the Lord, this is your mission.